I'm on. Hi, church. Good to see you here at worship with us. Otherwise, what would I do with myself if you didn't come? Let's pray together, shall we? Lord Jesus, you're building the church. That's my great hope. Not me, not men, you. And we have a great ability to derail it, sidetrack it, even defeat it, all with seemingly good intentions. So Lord, even today as we look at the early church, would you keep building your church here at Desert View, here in the Valley of the Sun? Lord, build your church. Add to her today. Open your kingdom to new ones, new babes in Christ today. Resist the devil today, Lord. Make your word come alive today. Feed your sheep today, Lord Jesus, we ask, and build your church all to the greatness of your name. Amen. I hope you were with us last week. That was a rich time, wasn't it? Just praying for one another and the freedom that we had in the Holy Spirit to just, if you weren't here at the end of the message, I invited people just to come forward who wanted prayer, who wanted to say with a fresh faith, Lord Jesus, here I am, I'm yours, or I need to be prayed for today. And you came freely, lots of you, and it was a great gift to us, the shepherd and staff who were able to pray with you. And it just encouraged me that the Holy Spirit is here. He seemed palpable, so present with us in that worship service. And I'm so grateful. I'm grateful for you who are praying for the Spirit's working in our church. That's our only hope, that the Holy Spirit will continue to be the influence in the life and mission of Desert View, not people. The question then that always comes after we've had an experience in the Holy Spirit, now what will we do with that? Because there's always a temptation to retreat back into what's comfortable and what we're used to. And so often, that's a place of isolation or disconnection from the body of Christ. It's just, it's the sin in us, it's the selfishness, it's the pride, it's the fear. All those things work to draw us back into our comfortable little world where we're busy and doing things, but we're not really connected into the life of the church. Here's the message I want you to hear loud and clear today. The Christian life, by design, is to be lived with other people. The Christian life, by design, is to be lived with other people. It was never meant to be a private, personal faith. Somehow, the wonderful World War II generation, what some like Tom Brokaw have called the greatest generation, the folks that went off to the European theater and the Pacific Rim and fought the Great War, and they came back, and it just fit the burdens that they were carrying from war. Maybe it fit the heavy emphasis of Scandinavians and Germans. I don't know, but it was a generation that didn't talk much. And so church became more something you went to. You went to church, you went to services, but you didn't talk about your faith. Your faith was something personal and private. In fact, you could even offend people if you tried to probe into the exact nature of their faith. It was more about what's your denomination, what's the label under which you come to God and worship, what are the rituals and ceremonies that you follow. And consequently, the life of the church began to wane. And that's part of what fueled the reaction in the 60s and 70s and what the Holy Spirit then did this Jesus movement. Remember that in the 60s and 70s? How many came to Christ in the Jesus movement like me? Some of you are old enough to admit that. And that's what the Spirit did. The Spirit just blew through a younger generation that had been turned off by the coldness, the sterileness of what they were experiencing in the formalized worship of the churches of that time. And the Spirit did a new work because that's what church is. Church is something that we are to live with others, not just attending meetings together, but doing life together. And that's my thesis today. The normal Christian life is a life that is lived with others. I want us to look in the book of Acts. Hope you have a Bible along with you so you can make sure I'm not making this stuff up. In Acts 1 and 2, you know, the book of Acts is really Luke 2. It's the follow-up to the Gospel of Luke. Jesus has now been resurrected. He's appeared to the disciples, and Acts chapter 1 opens up with his last words to them, and his last words are, okay, I want you all to wait until the Holy Spirit comes. And this book will be about what the Holy Spirit does when he comes upon God's people. And so they wait. And then comes this day of Pentecost in chapter 2, when suddenly a noise like a violent rushing wind fills the place where they were all gathered. And suddenly they're speaking in languages they were never taught, so that everyone who was there from all different people groups and dialects is hearing the gospel in their own tongue. It was a miraculous moment, and it was a fulfillment of the prophecy from the book of Joel. And that's the thing you love about the life of Christ, and that's part of the validation of the life of Christ, that Christ just kept fulfilling Old Testament prophecies, right down to the place, you know, little Bethlehem. Micah said, little Bethlehem, you little town that you are, you'll become the most famous of all the towns. Isaiah 53 described the crucifixion before that had really been invented as a form of execution. And so Acts 2 is another fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy that gives us confidence that God will keep his word. And if he kept his word then, now we can rest in the truth that he's going to keep his word about Christ's return. So the Holy Spirit comes and fills, and people are prophesying, and there's this sense of wonder, and Peter gets up and preaches, and it says that as for he preaches, if you have a Bible with me, in Acts 2:37, when they heard him declare the gospel that Jesus, whom they crucified, was God, and that he died for their sins, they were pierced to the heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, what should we do? This is true. We see now, this is true. This is what we have done. This Jewish community crucified Christ. Now, what do we do? And Peter says, repent, each of you, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that day, Luke tells us in verse 41, about 3,000 souls were immediately added to the movement. The Way, as it was called then, people of the Way. So what happens when the Holy Spirit freshly falls on a group of people? What do they do? That's instructive for us. The Holy Spirit falls fresh. They haven't read books on how to do church because they don't know anything about church. All they know is Judaism. And now the Holy Spirit is giving them new wine. And Jesus warned them. He said, you're not going to be able to put this new wine in the old wineskins. That is, when the Spirit comes and gives you new life in me, it's not going to fit the old Judaistic model of the synagogue. You're going to need some new wineskins. So what we're seeing in Acts 2 are the new wineskins, the new way for the people of God to respond to the movement of the Spirit of God. And here's what they do. Are you with me? And I have the verses there in the bulletin so you can see them as well. Acts 2:42. They were continually devoting themselves to the following five things. But I don't want to skip over that line. They were continually devoting themselves. See, immediately with the falling of the Holy Spirit on these people, there was a lifestyle change. We all devote ourselves to something. You all, each of you this week, will continually devote yourself to something. It may be your family, might be your grandkids, might be your work, might be your investments, might be your hobbies, but you will give yourself devotedly to something. It might be television, entertainment, but something will have you. Your lifestyle will be marked by something that you give yourself to. And what's so fascinating to me is these people had immediate lifestyle change. Whatever they were devoting themselves to before, and that is not to say those were bad things, now this is what they were giving themselves to. And that's what made this the talk of the city. That people that were doing the things you're supposed to devote yourself to, work and family, education, whatever, now they were devoting themselves to these things. And that's something to hang on to. When Christ has you, there will be a lifestyle change. When Christ has you, there will be a lifestyle change. Christ will not be content to be kind of squeezed into the other things you're devoted to. He's Lord. He's too big. He's too powerful. He's too profound. He's too good. He will not be content to just be fitted into your busy calendar. When Christ comes, he will, in love and grace, demand a lifestyle change. And it's highly frustrating when you try to resist that, because that's what he wants. And these people are continually now devoting themselves to things they never devoted themselves to before, a new way of living. They're going to homes now, and people are asking them, family members and friends, Jacob, where are you going? Oh, I'm going to the post-Pentecostal evangelism and discipleship training meeting. No, they didn't know what, we're going to Josh and Mary's house. Have you heard? The Holy Spirit has come upon us, and now we're just giving ourselves to be together, and it's so good, and why don't you come? What did they do when they got together? Let's look. Luke tells us, Acts 2:42, continually devoting themselves to the following five things. First of all, the apostles' teaching. And we have much of the apostles' teaching now. We have Peter, James, and John. We have their epistles and gospel. We also have Paul's writings, which will become of the body of literature that the church will study. Paul's letters will be circulated as his mission unfolds later on in the book of Acts. But they're pouring over, the apostles, that is, are now pouring over the Old Testament, because that's their scripture, right? The Old Testament is their scripture, and they have scrolls and writings, and they're now looking at the Old Testament with the glasses of Christ. And suddenly they see what John the Baptist meant when he saw Jesus. Remember, and he said, "Behold the Lamb of God." And every good Jew went back to Passover in Exodus, the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb. And so the thrill now for the apostles is they're seeing Jesus all through the Old Testament. And they're teaching it to the church. And that's doing some wonderful things now for the church. It's confirming that Jesus is the Messiah. And they're remembering the things that Jesus said and how he didn't come to destroy the law, but to fulfill all that was written from Moses and the prophets. And so their faith in the veracity of the scripture is being confirmed. They're being confirmed in the forgiveness of sins. And the apostles are saying, you know how before it was the blood of bulls and goats? Now that's all been fulfilled in Christ. They're confirmed in God's acceptance of them. You are now forgiven forever. No more ritual or sacrifice on your part. The church has always had this common book. It's fun that wherever you go in the world, anywhere on the planet, where there are Christians meeting under the leading of the Holy Spirit, the Bible will always be at the center of that. In fact, that's one of the clues. If any church is meeting and the Bible isn't at the center of what they're preaching and teaching and in the center of their worship and their discipling of their children, if the Bible's not the center of that, the Holy Spirit's probably not there either. Because that's what he does. The Holy Spirit is the one who superintended the writings of men to give us this unique book, and it's our common witness. It's precious to those whose eyes have been enlightened by the Spirit. You've probably talked to people who don't have the Holy Spirit and they don't get this book. In fact, scholars who don't have the Holy Spirit, build careers on taking this book apart, because it's true. Without the Holy Spirit, it's kind of an odd, confusing book. And you can pull things out that seem to be contradictory, or this seems like this is kind of bizarre or cruel, because they don't have the understanding of the Spirit to see the themes, to understand the real message of this book. But when you have the Holy Spirit, it's an amazing thing how this book becomes your food, your rock, your confidence, your light. Margie and I, we had Bibles in our home growing up, but we didn't have the Spirit of God, her and I, and we're in college, and when we finally were saved and the Spirit fell upon us, the first thing we wanted to do was go buy a Bible. I mean, that's kind of hilarious. If you'd asked me just 24 hours earlier, would you like to go buy a Bible, I'd be like, what? Yeah, and then let's go to the dentist and have a root canal. What? Why would I want a Bible? And now, with the Spirit of God, that's the first thing we wanted to do. We went to the bookstore and said, you guys have Bibles? And they kind of scratched their head. Yeah, we do, in the back there, we have some Bibles. And yes, even at ASU, they stole Bibles in the bookstore. It's our common book. It's an inspired book. And only the child of God, born again by the Spirit of God, can see the glory and the truths that feed you and encourage you and strengthen you and get you through things that you had no idea you could ever survive, withstand, but the truth of the Word. But here's the other thing. Don't miss this. In 242, they are devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching together. Together. That's another thing we've done is we've made Bible study this private devotion. And there's nothing wrong with your own private devotion, but the book was made to be a community book. It was made to study and talk about in community because that's how God made us. He made us all different. We have different gifts. We have different backgrounds. We have different cultural resources to draw on, and so it brings richness to the Word when we study it together. That's why our small groups here at Desert View, we always have some time in the Word because the Word comes to life in a fresh way when we're studying in community. Even if it's just two or three of you, you know, at the coffee shop together opening the Word just seems to come to life in fresh ways with others more than just by yourself. That, again, is by design. It's a common book to be shared and to be discussed together. The Spirit speaks through others as we chew on these truths. I think I've told you about the big church in Chicago, Willow Creek Community Church, Bill Hybels, 25,000 people or something like that on a weekend come there to worship. They were the ones that first initiated the idea of a seeker service, a weekend service that would draw in unchurched people. And they did a survey recently of all the churches in their association, in the Willow Creek Association, like over 1,500 churches. So that's thousands of Christians. And as they filled out the survey and they analyzed the data, they were able to put people in different places in terms of their growth, just to do some categorizing of the information. So you had people who were still trying to understand who Christ was. Then you had people who had come to Christ. Then you had people who were really growing in Christ. And then the last quadrant were people where Christ was really the center of their life. And they wanted to know, what are the dynamics? What are the things that cause people to move from that place where they actually come to believe in Christ to being a Christ-centered person? What are the ingredients? What are the things that must happen? There were some surprises. One of the things that wasn't that helpful is no matter how busy people got doing church service, that didn't necessarily increase their growth in Christ. You know what the number one consistent ingredient in all four stages of development from seeking Christ to being Christ-centered, the one consistent ingredient was always the Word of God. Now, when we read that, you know, we kind of rolled our eyes like, oh, I'm glad they figured that out. We didn't know that before. Yeah, it's always been that way. Jesus said, Father, sanctify them by thy truth. Thy word is truth. The other thing they found out is that the word really grows when you're meeting with someone else. If even just one other person, there's more power for the word to feed and teach and grow us than just alone. So that's our common book. And so the first thing we see these folks doing is they're devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching. And the next thing it says is to fellowship, which means coffee and donuts. The word there, you know, is koinonia. Koinonia. I think in the 80s and 90s, every church in America had a koinonia Sunday school class, didn't they? Larry, didn't you always? I mean, that was the cool Greek term for a Sunday school class. We're the koinonia class. Everybody had one. It means what we share as a brotherhood and sisterhood. It means that there's something that makes us all the same. It's our common beliefs, our common worship all around Christ, that there is real unity. Koinonia means we're experiencing a genuine unity around the common ground of Christ. So when it says that they were devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, it means simply they were starting to do life together. To do life together. It's what Jesus said. They asked him, he was teaching and his family, his mother and brothers were looking for him. It was a time in his ministry when his family didn't quite know what to do with him. And so they've come to talk to him because opposition is starting to grow and they thought maybe that was unnecessary. And so someone came in and said, Jesus, your mother and brothers are outside. And Jesus said, who are my brothers and sisters? Is it not these people who want the will of God and the word of God? That's the common life. And that's what many of you discover, that when you find others who love Christ, the bond that you have with other Christians is as strong as any family bond. It's a place of acceptance. No matter what we have achieved in this life, we understand we need a Savior. That's the common ground. That's why communion is so powerful. No matter who we are, age, gender, education, money, this is our common ground. We need a Savior. And the truth of that is so good. You know, in an AA meeting, everybody starts out by introducing themselves, only their first name, and they all acknowledge, hi, I'm Sandy, I'm an alcoholic. Hi, I'm Joe, I'm an alcoholic. And it's the restating of that common ground. The only reason I'm here, you don't need to know anything else about me. The only thing I want you to know is I need what we all need, sobriety. Sometimes I wish we should do that in church. You know, everybody should just walk in and go, hi, I'm Mary, a sinner. That's what we're doing here, really. We're just coming together, reminding each other we're a sinner that needs a Savior. That's our common life, our common ground. And the truth is that without sharing that life in Christ with other people, you will dry up. I mean, it is just 100% true. When I run into someone whose Christian life has suddenly lost life and vibrancy and meaning and purpose, 100% of the time, they have lost contact with any fellowship of other believers. It's just guaranteed. You know, and they'll scratch their head and go, I don't know what happened. I guess they just stopped going. And I don't know. Well, it's made to be a shared life. It's made to be a shared life. And the fire burns together. If you take one log out of the fire and sit over here by itself, that fire goes out on that log. We need each other. So the devil's main strategy to you, believer, is what? To isolate you from other Christians. And that's what we see happen. Someone has something happen in their life that's painful, embarrassing. There's been brokenness. Maybe there's a divorce or a financial setback. And so the evil one whispers to them, oh, you don't want those people to know. Or what are you going to say now? They're all going to be asking you questions. I mean, he's just right there in your head to tell you why you need to avoid Christians, which is just what he wants to do, because now he's going to diminish the flame of the Spirit in your life. We need each other. We need real fellowship, really sharing our lives with each other. Well, let's go on. So they're giving themselves first to the apostles' teaching, to the word, then to sharing life together, this fellowship. Thirdly, it says to breaking bread. And there's two things that we understand, and both are essential to church life. First of all, it can mean they were just having a meal. And God's wired us that way. When we have a meal, it breaks down barriers, and people begin to relax and laugh, and connection happens through a meal. One of the best things you can do is have people over to your home and have a meal together. It creates a new bond, a new connection with one another. And so the early church, they just got that. They started meeting together and they're having a meal. And Paul writes about that in Corinthians. They called it a love feast, and everybody was potluck. See, potlucks are biblical. And everybody would bring what they had and they'd share it. And then as part of that love feast, they would also have communion. And it's important to see that the early church was remembering Christ's death, remembering his sacrifice, and there wasn't professional clergy in all those homes. But there was respect for what it represented. In fact, Paul had to write that. Remember, to the Corinthian church, said, now some of you, when you're meeting, you're going to the Lord's table and you're eating because you're hungry rather than remembering. Some of you, he said, are coming drunk to the table. So he had to straighten them out and say, you know, show some respect. Remember what you're remembering when you do this. But it was never meant to be a meal that only the professionals could handle. And that has been a great loss of the church. And so we encourage you in your community groups, in your 2.0 groups, you can have communion. You have permission from the leadership of Desert View. But when you have communion, do it respectfully. Capture the moment. Remember what it is a picture of. Remember Christ's suffering and his great love. And then maybe share. Christ would want us to do that. Share what Christ means to you and then take the elements and remember. But this is not to be a professionally served meal. It's to be the common meal of the people of God. I remember my friend Robbie Reisner, who was a prisoner of war for 7 years in Vietnam. And he said they allowed them to meet, but they wouldn't give them anything for communion. So, and they had no Bible. So a person, he said, I now see why scripture memory is so important. The men who had been to Sunday school and knew scripture would share the scripture. He said, and then we would just do communion. We didn't have any bread, we didn't have any wine, but we just went through the motions. So I would break the invisible bread and pass it, and we'd take it and eat it. He said it was one of the most powerful communion meals we've ever had because it was capturing the moment and remembering the Savior who loved you. So the people gathered around the apostles teaching. They were sharing life together. They're having meals and having communion together. And then their common language, prayer. They were praying. Again, prayer is to be something that happens in community. We've taken Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount too far. You know, Jesus was trying to get at the Pharisees who had turned praying into something that happened in public by the professionals to impress the poor dumb lay people. And Jesus had that up to here. So he said, when you're going to pray, don't pray in public to impress people like the Pharisees. Go into your closet and do it in secret, and then your Father in heaven who sees what in secret, he'll answer your prayer. Now that doesn't mean, Jesus wasn't saying, so all prayer has to be individual and secretive. He was countering the hypocrisy of the Pharisees. But we see when the Holy Spirit came upon the church and people were gathering in homes and having meals and studying the scriptures, they prayed together. And imagine the scene, because these are people, some of you can relate to this if you came from a church background where you were never allowed to pray out loud, only the professionals did. That's the situation here, and now these new Jewish converts are encouraging one another, saying, you don't need a high priest to do that. You can go right in the presence of a holy God. Imagine the wonder. Imagine the tears of gratitude as these dear, fresh new believers, for the first time in their life, lifted their eyes to heaven and said, Father, do you know me? Do you hear my prayer? Father, I want to pray for my family. I want to thank you for what I have experienced by your Holy Spirit. Those had to be some of the sweetest moments in prayer, huh? As these people grasp what had been given to them. Because nothing communicates the work of Christ in opening up the Holy of Holies like prayer. I'm sure this was the richest part of their time together. It's what united them. It's where they opened up their hearts to each other and to God as they just poured out what was burdening them. How sad that now we've made prayer something that you just do privately on your own and you would never dare pray in public with other people. So some of you have grown up loving Christ all your life and you've never prayed with other Christians out loud because somehow that wasn't appropriate or you weren't worthy or some tragic, lousy teaching. When Christians come together under the ministry of the Holy Spirit, they're going to want to pray. They're going to want to pray. If you don't know what to pray, that's why we have the Word.
Pray the Psalms back to the Father. Pray the Psalms. You'll be amazed how the Psalms will express your heart, because the Psalms are very honest and real. Lord, I'm your friend. Look how you're treating me. Where are you? How come the bad guys seem like they're winning? Lord, I'm so tired of crying myself to sleep, Psalm 3 and 4. Pray the Psalms. Pray the Scriptures. Singing is prayer. Some of you think singing is just the preliminaries to the service, right? No. Singing is prayer. It's prayers put to music. They met and they prayed. Verse 43, and everyone kept feeling a sense of awe, and many wonders and signs were taking place through the apostles. And then an amazing thing happened. All those who believed were together, and they had all things in common, and they began selling property and possessions and sharing with them as anyone might have need. Because remember, there was a financial consequence to coming to Christ. Your Jewish boss was not excited that you were now a Christian and that you were defiling his business by being one of those people. Your family may have said, you're now dead to me, son. You're now dead to me, daughter. If you're going to be a follower of that cult, that dead itinerant preacher, if you're going to join that and give up Judaism and Moses and the law, then you're dead to us. So there was financial realities that immediately came to the table, and the church responded. You can't keep Christians from meeting needs. That's the beauty of it. I've been in the other kind of church where Christians aren't meeting together in small groups, so they don't hear about needs. So everything gets done through the professionals. So this professional staff does all the visiting and has to figure out who has financial need and meet those needs, and then everybody's grumpy because you can never meet the needs when it's just a tired small staff that's supposed to be doing everything. It's so much more fun when what's happening here at Desert View, you now are ministered to through the people you meet in your groups. So whether it's a community group or it's a table at Women in the Word, needs are always being met here in this church because it's just what Christians do. They hear of a need and they respond. So that's what happened. The Holy Spirit came on these people, and immediately they wanted to be together. They wanted to share life. They wanted to talk about the apostles' teaching. They took communion together. They wanted to pray. And as they heard needs, they met needs. Sounds like a pretty cool fellowship, doesn't it? Yeah. And by God's grace, we have a taste of that here at Desert View. In fact, I hope in your BTC groups, who's in one of our five-week BTC groups? Just raise your hand. Oh, you really drank the Kool-Aid, didn't you? All right, good. Thank you. No, I hope your BTC group will experience the things we're talking about right here. That's our hope and prayer. And you'll start, I think, tonight and Monday night, and you'll review what we've looked at in Acts 2 and begin to say, how can we experience that together? We're going to close our service with a benevolence offering, which is a way that we meet the needs of the body. And we run through thousands of dollars. I think last year we gave away some $60,000 direct need here in the fellowship, and because of your generosity, we do that. As we do that, you're going to watch a video by one of our men in the fellowship, Don Leckie, who has begun to experience what we've read here in Acts 2. So as the ushers come to receive the benevolent offering, we'll see Don's interview.